And who came up with that name, New Romantics?
Some called it the cult with no name, while others branded them peacock punks or blitz kids. With their pretty boy makeup and Byronic good looks, these princes of pop would go down in history as the New Romantics. At the dawn of the 80s, this artistic group of writers, designers, musicians, and clubgoers created one of the most colourful and innovative scenes in modern popular culture. And memorably spawned pop acts such as Spandau Ballet, Adam and the Ants, Duran Duran, and Culture Club. Boys, boys keep swinging, boys always working. The creative spark for future New Romantics occurred in the early 70s, with Top of the Pops performances by glam rock artists like David Bowie and T-Rex.
I think David Bowie made it all right for guys to play with their femininity, for guys to be girls if they wanted to.
When I was a kid, Bowie, you know, was like a light at the end of the tunnel. I was living in suburbia. I knew I was gay, I didn't fit in. Suddenly this guy comes along, you know, singing about queers and looking the way he did. There's a Starman
waiting in the sky. Seeing David Bowie do Starman on Top of the Pops really did change my life. He came from a planet that I wanted to visit.
I was banned from school when I was about 13 for having bright orange hair, and that was when I was going through a Bowie phase.
Living in the suburb of Manchester that I lived in, it was just like music from another planet.
With the arrival of punk, satin was replaced by safety pins and mascara by Mohicans, as androgyny gave way to anarchy and aggression.
I remember there was this one very important piece of press where there was a photograph of a teddy boy holding a brick, and it was like punks versus teds, and literally overnight, this war started.
When I first saw George, he was 15, and I think he was wearing a wedding dress and a policeman's hat. And for an Irish working class kid from South London, hat and half brave.
I can remember actually being on a bus with a girlfriend of mine and getting kicked in the face by a teddy boy, like literally just came up. I was sitting on the back of the bus and he walked up and just booted me in the face.
The original audience couldn't go out any longer. We didn't stick safety pins through our face, we didn't gob at everybody, and we didn't want to fight anybody.
We were kids who grew up with the mythology of swinging London. Well, London in 1978 didn't swing. It was like Bulgaria on a bad night. This town.
Come in like a ghost town.
All the clubs have been closed down.
No money, no work, no clubs, dark and bleak. That's what we had.
In 1979, all dressed up but with nowhere safe to go, two club pioneers started a Bowie night at Billy's in Soho. Steve Strange and Rusty Egan.
They were the gruesome twosome of the time, you know, the hinge and bracket of New Romanticism. A lot of people think of Rusty as kind of Steve's foil. He was the guy that organised the clubs and probably got up early and did things. Steve was the sort of, you know, swanning around genius.
The whole idea of, like, sort of taking a club over and it sort of being yours for the night hadn't been done maybe since the 60s or something.
I thought, I'll just play records in a club and invite my friends.
And the minute I walked down them steps, that was it, you were home, you knew.
I found something that I could belong to, that this was ours, this was my turn.
On the opening night, we must have had about 150 people in there. And then by the third week, there was like queues around the block.
I said, Steve, you stand on the door and make sure that those blokes who want to beat us up don't come in. You've got a doorman.
Only blonde. Sorry, you're not blonde enough.
And then Steve took it from there. Well, like, you know, you look great, but you can't come in those shoes. Oh, we can be heroes.
played the arse off of David Bowie's Heroes. I mean, you could not go out of that stage without hearing. If you went anywhere where there's someone who liked New Romantic stuff, you'd hear Heroes playing in the background.
There were people dancing with, and Marilyn was there, and there was a sex change behind the bar, and I was 16, and I was like, blimey, this is fantastic. Here comes the mirror man, says
he's a people fan. Here comes the mirror man. We went through the ecclesiastical phase, where it was very much like priest robes.
My nun's outfit was pretty happening.
I can see that's maybe quite funny, but there's no way I want to go out dressed as a nun. Unless I am a nun.
Are you ready yet?
Yeah, I'm taking my time.
I swear, piles of makeup. Quite a lot of makeup, really.
I mean, it's like, oh no, here comes Marilyn. It's like, oh fuck.
You'd sort of walk around a corner and old ladies would fall over.
Makeup was the big thing. Makeup and L-net. And we used to get our makeup done for nothing some nights. You'd go down to Selfridges at 5:30 and go to the Madeline Mono counter, and the girls there would like do a makeover on you.
I might have put a bit of blush on once, I'm not sure. I didn't really feel comfortable with the makeup I did. It wasn't a sexuality thing, I just thought it looked a bit too daft. But I did like the hair lack. I used to spray my hair up, and I quite liked a bit of Diamante. I remember once feeling quite daring going out with my collar turned up and a Diamante crucifix on, thinking I looked like Jack the Biscuit.
At Billy's, the new romantic movement began to take shape. Makeup, frills and big hair were central to the look, and DJ Rusty Egan's adventurous mix of music provided the soundtrack. She's a
model and she's looking good. I play glam rock, Mark Bolan, etc. Mix that up with electronic stuff, with craft work, with, you know.
In those days, a disco didn't have a hip DJ. It didn't have a DJ that was the star of the show.
And I wasn't a DJ. Hi. I put records on. That's what I did.
It wasn't rock and roll. But it wasn't disco as well, you know, it was somewhere in between.
Gary Kemp was a regular at Billy's. Every Tuesday night, he soaked up the club's inspirational atmosphere with the rest of his band, the Spandau Ballet.
I remember saying, we've got to go out and buy a synthesizer.
Over the period of late 78 and 79 in the rehearsal studio, the band gradually changed from being what essentially was a rock, pop type sound to a modern synthesized type dance sound.
But new romantic music wasn't just about synthesizers. Although most acts adopted the new technology, Adam and the Ants got their inspiration from the Burundi beats of Africa, using two drummers to create tribal rhythms which matched Adam's warrior image.
I got the 8th Hussar jacket from my friend Dave at Berman's, because I really liked that jacket. It's worn in that Charge of the Light Brigade by David Hemmings. You felt quite like a buccaneer, you know, sort of stealing clothes as you went along and putting it all together, like wearing it.
We wanted to sell records. We wanted to be a pop band in the sort of true early 70s tradition of, like, you know, T-Rex.
Although attention was focused mainly on London, elsewhere in Britain, new romanticism was thriving underground, especially in Birmingham, home of the Rum Runner Club and Duran Duran.
The Rum Runner was amazing. It was our little domain. We rehearsed there, and we worked there, and we played there.
Were there clubs in Birmingham?
The people up in Birmingham were the nicest people. You know, used to go up there in London, everyone's kind of posy, being all stuck up, and in Birmingham, everyone would like come up to you and go, where do y'all come from?
I lived in London, and I kind of wasn't really interested in what was happening, you know, in the provinces. Really.
At Penny's in Sheffield, it was fantastic because there would be an interlude, like an amnesty, where, you know, you get like kind of brickies in eyeliner would get up and mince.
There's no question that the London scene sort of looked on us as being slightly provincial, but we didn't mind that. It's nice being the underdog. It didn't do us any harm.
People of our generation have been influenced by disco, dance, by punk, by glam, Bowie, Roxy. You know. They were bound to make this big amalgamation in 1979.
Back in London, the great success of Tuesday nights at Billy's encouraged Rusty Egan and Steve Strange to switch the club to a much bigger venue, the Blitz in Covent Garden.
Steve sat in the door in a different outfit every week, trying to top the outfit that would be worn by either Boy George, Marilyn, Philip Salon, or a plethora of others. Boys, and the times are changing,
we're going again. Some people think that if they put a wetsuit on and painted their face black and white, that they'd get in. And I'd say, no, I'm sorry, it's a private party, you can't come in. Boys,
there wasn't that many places you could go and look weird. So you had to kind of have your own little clubs. But I think people like Steve kind of took it too far. And, you know, people were humiliated. It was embarrassing.
When Mick Jagger came up, the club was so full that we just had a warning from the fire people that if we let in one more person, that basically that we would lose our licence.
And he went, sorry, mate, for that. And they were like, well, you know, it's Mick Jagger. I said, I'm full like, who? He don't look like Mick Jagger. You know, of course, Mick Jagger went out in a pair of jeans and an old jacket.
I was actually quite angry about that because I thought, well, Mick Jagger's done a lot more than you have. So why are you turning him away?
There'd be a queue of people desperate to get in, but you'd swan, and believe me, we could swan. You'd swan to the front, you'd pull rank, you'd go in, you'd kiss Steve on the cheek.
I remember Steve Strange at the door and just thinking, he's looking at me and he's thinking maybe I'm not up to it, and then getting through the door and thinking, yes!
Steve Strange employed me, rather foolishly, to work in the cloakroom.
George would be there taking your coat and calling you every name under the sun because he was always the most bitter and twisted of the lot. And Marilyn was his kind of sidekick.
There'd be a... You know, when you walk through the door and it's like, I haven't made a hit record or anything, and I just walk in and be that thing that I was doing.
The women's toilets would be full of men hogging the mirror.
There'd be someone done up like Gandhi in one corner, and someone else as a 1920s film director, and a third person as a Pierrot or whatever. Do you remember a Garth's beer?
David Bowie came to the Blitz to select people for his Ashes to Ashes video. Steve Strange, you know, obviously was the king of the Blitz, so he got to sit on Bowie's table.
And Steve's posing, like letting everyone know I'm sitting with, without actually going, you know.
When he asked me, you know, would I do this, I was like, you know, he's asking me to do this video, and it was just like amazing.
I didn't want to be in Ashes to Ashes and walk along the beach going, ashes to ash and fun to
fuck it. We know Major Tom's a junkie. When he went up the stairs, loads of them, they all went running up the stairs and they were all going, Bowie, Bowie, with their arms in the air. Like loads of them, it was like kind of hailing Caesar.
I remember thinking, how can he deal with this? You know, because these people are literally up his bum, and I don't need to add to that. So I just went back to the cloakroom.
Although Bowie wasn't of that scene by any means whatsoever, he's always been a very clever leech, an absorber of things, a sucker of blood.
I remember when I saw it on Top of the Pops, like Steve Strange and Judith Franklin, I just thought, oh, you know, it annoyed the hell out of me.
The fact is, they received £50 for being in the video for a day's work, which was an absolute fortune then.
Once the New Romantic thing started, everybody wanted to be famous. So everybody was forming bands and trying to get these kind of records out.
Inspired by David Bowie's patronage, Steve and Rusty craved pop fame of their own. They formed Visage, a studio group of assorted musicians including Midgeur and Billy Curry from Ultravox. And in late 1980, Visage put the New Romantics in the top 10 with Fade to Grey.
Billy came with the bass line, dun 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 dun, straight for beat that he programmed.
It's not actually me talking in French because I can't speak French.
And I said, we should get my girlfriend, she's French, and we should get her to speak in French. And Midge wrote the melody line with the lyric, and then she recited the lyric in French, and basically it created this feel.
Everything was done in 24 hours, literally. All that makeup, where my body's sprayed silver, where my body's painted black. I've been in a bath and scrubbed with a Brillo pad.
When I see that video, I really remember. It really brings back memories. And it's funny because, you know, at the time, I couldn't allow myself to like it because it was like, he got into the charts before I did.
And then I had to have that, you know, that was a sound that I was working on at the time, electronic drums mixed with real drums.
And then all of a sudden, it went to number one in about 9 countries.
I appeared from under a cloth. I spun my head round a bit, and a bit of hands. Un homme dans une gare isolée, une valise à ses côtés. A couple of people asked me for my autograph in the doll queue.
I can look back at it now and I think, you know, actually it wasn't a great record, but it was of the moment.
But it wasn't only the musicians who were making names for themselves. Influential writers, photographers and designers, mainly from London's St Martin's School of Art, all began to emerge from the Blitz club scene.
There were probably about 150 people in the room. And I would guess that at least 100 of those went on to be very successful in their chosen path.
People were ambitious. I mean, you know, we weren't all kind of just frivolous fun. I mean, you know, everyone had their eye on the prize of money, you know, they wanted success.
They were aspirational, calculational, publicity conscious, all those things, fashion conscious. They weren't romantic.
People were creating businesses for themselves. And I think that Spandau Ballet kind of latched onto that. You know, their manager, Steve Dagger, was part of the scene. And he saw the potential for marketing Spandau Ballet. Everything counts in
large amounts. I wasn't some sort of a businessman who was kind of taking advantage of the situation without being part of it. And the group were the same. They weren't. They were part of the scene.
We couldn't get our band together and go and play regular clubs because, you know, these guys weren't interested in going to regular clubs, you know. We had to play there, or we had to go and find a venue, like a battleship or an art house cinema.
Spandau Ballet were first caught on camera at London's La Scala Cinema in the spring of 1980. Performing between European art films, they were given a poetic introduction from budding style journalist Robert Elms.
I remember Robert Elms kind of, you know, coming on at the Scala and reading this kind of avant-garde poem, you know. I mean, none of us took it seriously. Like, shut up, get on with the music, you know.
From half-spoken shadows emerges a canvas. A kiss of light breaks to reveal a moment when all mirrors are redundant.
A curtain drops, you know, mist in the future. It was just, you know what I mean? It was like, you just thought it was a joke, you know, get a life.
Listen to the portrait of the dance of perfection.
Gary had a book on German expressionism, and I think it was meant to look like the Bauhaus or something. In fact, it looked like toy house. But it was great. And, you know, and I stood there with this light across my face and recited this pretentious poetry that ended.
The Spandau Ballet.
And we had this set of rather stark electronic songs with the drums just going boom, 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 boom. We bravely decided to become the house band. And I say bravely because these guys weren't interested in looking at anyone but themselves.
Bands like Spandau, I mean, they were gung-ho for fame. You know, they wanted to be famous, and they definitely used the scene to get as much attention as possible.
The movement was now attracting national media coverage, but the established rock press still wouldn't jump on the new romantic bandwagon.
It's a club thing, and in a sense, asking the NME to cover it is a bit like asking Anglers Weekly to do drag racing.
They just saw the new romantic thing as like ponces, you know, it was like London ponces with big hairdos.
It was a very small scene and it wasn't what they were into, so you can sort of understand in a way why none of these people from sort of drifted up to the Blitz. Perhaps some of them did, but certainly they wouldn't have got in the door.
What they needed was OK or Hello or the magazine culture that would have embraced them in a kind of large photograph, very small amount of text, very uncritical kind of thing.
Unable to gain support from the influential NME, the new romantics decided to create their own magazines.
It's interesting that you know, ID and The Face certainly started out within months of each other in 1980.
When you bought a paper on a Sunday, it didn't have a bit that said style. That was a foreign word. The Face started doing it. And because it started doing it so brilliantly and chronicling it so well, suddenly it became the Bible.
The wonderful thing about ID in particular is that they featured things from London, from Sheffield, from Liverpool, from Birmingham. And if you were a proto-punk or a young goth in the middle of nowhere, you could go and buy this magazine and think, hey, I'm not a freak. There are other people like me.
It caused a lot of commotion going out. People used to get really angry. You know, they'd be upset by the sight of some of these people.
It wasn't just a dressing up of a nighttime moment. You've actually wore these clothes all day long and fled for your life if you come across the wrong sort of people walking down the road the other way.
I mean, people might have shouted at you. They still do.
I mean, clothes don't really make you different, but to other people it does. It's like, gosh, you're interesting. Because what? Because I've got this shirt on.
I could have a really interesting conversation with some old bag and a laundrette, you know, probably much more interesting than I could at the Blitz Club. A lot of the people that were there were, you know, they had nothing to say. But then equally, there were some really exciting people who were really creative and, you know, it was just a real mixture.
It was just like a place for posers to kind of pose around at and say, I've been to the Blues, you know, and wear dark glasses, which is very 80s, isn't it?
You'd go along to the bar and get yourself a very, very pretentious looking cocktail and stand there in your outfit with something with umbrellas in.
Then you'd go out and you'd dance a bit. So much you can't hide. Yeah. Put on a little makeup,
make sure they get your good side. You have to remember that the Blitz dance floor was about the size of a postage stamp, so you couldn't really flail your arms around or do anything wildly creative.
You couldn't really dance too much in those clothes, you see, so you couldn't really move around that much, especially if you had heels on. So it was very sort of handbag on the floor kind of dancing.
If there was a drug of choice, it was probably speed, which had been the punk drug of choice and the cheap drug of choice. Fashion,
that'd be a joke. I'd go off, I'd buy some speed, these speckled blues, that apparently were really good because they had strychnine in them.
And you could get that cough mixture with morphine in too. It's lovely.
When you're young and you haven't got much cash, it's, you know, cheaper than numerous pints of beer, isn't it?
Everyone now thinks that everybody was dressed as Coco the Clown. Well, some were, and some were dressed as pirates, and some were dressed as all sorts of things. But it was another whole side that was considerably more heterosexual. The look of
We loved the gay element. It made it. It made it more entertaining, more fun.
It was a great mix, I mean, but it was absolutely rampant. I mean, like, sex and drugs were what it was all about, and you could sleep your way through the Blitz in about 6 months.
You'd be sort of getting off with girls and getting off with boys, and then they'd be getting off with each other. It was all a bit confusing, really.
By the end of the night, the Blitz was an extraordinary sight.
By the end of the night, people would normally be going, nah, 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 because they had so many drugs.
Honestly, it looked like a song by the end of the evening. I mean, people were just like that. Makeup had run, hair had gone, hairspray had kind of gone into clothing.
It looked worse on probably the boys than it did on the girls. Because when the boys are getting their sort of 5 o'clock shadow and the makeup's running down, it's not a pretty sight.
And you would hope that at the end of the night you might go home with someone, you know, the same sex, the opposite sex, no sex at all, you were never quite sure.
On the way home, obviously the milkman had been, so we'd just pick up as many pints as we could carry, and we'd go back to the squat with like 20 pints of milk each, and that was lunch, dinner and tea.
You don't want to merge into the background. You want to stand out from that background. Most kids, when you're in your teens and early 20s, you do it because you want attention, because, you know, you feel that you're worth attention. Also, it's obviously, you know, as soon as you become sexually aware, you want to get out there and promote yourself.
There are five young guys from Islington who are causing a real buzz in the music industry, and we've got them on Top of the Pops tonight.
I remember the very first single, which I was so desperately keen to get, Cut a Long Story Short, which I've still got on 12-inch vinyl somewhere. And I remember the dance people used to do, that silly dance where they put one leg up and then the other leg and do.
I was always awfully glad we never wore kilts. Not that I dislike them.
We like looking completely mad, you know. I mean, there was smocks and tunics and cloth and... But, you know, none of it was designer stuff. You couldn't buy any of this stuff. It was all kind of either made by friends or students, or we found it in second-hand stores.
And I'm thinking, yes, our time has come. We new romantics will conquer the world. And they look back and think, oh no, it's a bunch of kids dressed up in baggy pants.
In late 1980, with their first single high in the UK charts, Spandau Ballet played their first ever gig outside London at Birmingham's Botanical Gardens.
We got to Birmingham and the promoter said, look, this band Duran Duran, would it be okay if they did a support slot? And I said, fuck off. I said, I'm not having some group from Birmingham on our bill.
I remember talking to this one guy and he would say, oh, we've got a band. We've got a band. We'd just really quite like you, you know. And I think it was Simon Le Bon, actually.
We actually saw them play at a place called the Botanical Gardens in Birmingham. And when we left there, we were smiling. We just sort of said, well, what's that about?
I often wish that I'd said yes, because then I could have had a poster with Spandau Ballet and Duran Duran written quite small underneath. So that was a regret.
Meanwhile, back on the wild frontier, Adam and the Ants had also successfully launched their campaign to conquer the top 10.
As a statement of intent, that whole unplug the jukebox, do yourself a favour, that music's lost its taste, let's try another flavour. It was a kind of statement, a rebellion against the stuff that had been before and saying, yeah, okay, right, this is what a band should look and sound like now.
A guy like Adam Ant, he was a Scarlet Pimpernel. You know, his shows were like Broadway shows when you went and saw them. You'd never seen anything like it if you were 17 living in Sheffield.
Adam and the Ants destroyed their former punk credibility by starring at the 1981 Royal Variety performance, which put them right at the centre of pop's mainstream.
A lot of what we were trying to do was sort of anti-kind of rock and roll and anti-punk rock, and that seemed to be the most anti-punk rock thing that we could do, the thing that would really annoy the enemy the most.
Now, when we met the royal family afterwards, I felt quite 18th century. I felt like, sort of, you know, whipping the coat off and letting her walk on my jacket. And she said, I didn't recognise you. I think she would have preferred it if I'd have had the clubber on.
And spinning like an apple just outside the top 40, Duran Duran.
I remember so clearly when Duran Duran were first on Top of the Pops. I think it was Planet Earth and they came out. They were in these ludicrous kind of frilly shirts and sort of, you know, scars around their foreheads. And I just thought they were fantastic.
I do remember the first Top of the Pops. Frilly shirts. Absolutely.
I personally remember sort of like, you know, hearing them and seeing them and thinking, oh, they got it wrong, you know. You know, they got it right, obviously, because they made a lot of money. But at the time, you know, it was a real snobber. It's like, oh, they're from up north, you know. What do they know about new romanticism? But they had the big hit. Can you hear me now?
This is Planet Earth. You're looking at Planet Earth. A lot of people, you know, from the provinces, like Duran Duran, who actually used the word new romantic in a song, which I thought was an obscenity, you know, but they're a ridiculous bunch of people anyway.
The words new romantic are in Planet Earth. We were very aware of that. We took them right out of that magazine and went, oh, that's funny, look, they're trying to put this in a box already. That was early Duran irony.
And we laughed our heads off. We got this record and says one new romantic. And we just fell about laughing and we made the record into an ashtray.
I guess in a way, Duran Duran sort of brought it to the masses. They brought the frilly shirt thing to the masses.
With new romantic bands dominating the British charts, suddenly everyone wanted to read about them, write about them, and of course, dress like them. Media fascination with the cult grew as big as a bouffant hairdo. But what on earth could you call them?
The papers can call it what they like. They can call it the new romantic, the blitz kid, or whatever. I'd rather call it the cult with no name, because the papers can never put one finger on it.
The term new romantic really came about because no other names were sticking. I suppose that's when things really did all change. You know, you were getting things in the Sun and the Mirror saying how to be in a romantic and how to copy Steve Strange's makeup.
Suddenly, you had a mainstream icon embracing the new romantic look, and you had the high street rushing to catch up with it, and you then had everyone else thinking, right, this is the next look.
Well, from BBC Television.
Oh, yes.
I'm wearing the new romantic look.
Oh, yes.
And this is evidently going to catch on. What do you think of it?
Well, it doesn't turn me on.
Three things really stick in my mind about the things that I used to wear. Frilly blouses, big into the frilly blouses. Pixie boots, which were just an essential part of your dress. Everyone used to wear a scarf. You'd get it and you'd get the triangle like that. Get the edges and just tie it like this around your neck. And so it would all kind of go. It was just ridiculous.
On a mass level, it went mass, and on the individual level, people went where it could take them.
There were these electro bands, which were like Depeche Mode, there were Soft Cell. And so, you know, you had these bands coming up, which were actually probably doing slightly smarter music, really. Tainted love, don't touch me,
please, I cannot stand the way you tease. Tainted Love by Soft Cell was a great record. That kind of showed the way the whole scene was basically expanding all over the country.
The influence spread across the industrial north when diverse acts like the Human League and ABC broke through commercially with their own takes on the scene.
In a funny kind of way, our music was very romantic. You know, a song like All of My Heart or The Look of Love, Poison Arrow, those are very romantic songs. If I were to say to you,
that was very, very much like a new romantic album. But by then it wasn't called that anymore. Then they kind of said, oh, well, here's, you know, this is kind of modern soul. I think they called it White Soul or something.
Don't You Want Me by Human League and Poison Arrow by ABC
in a way, kind of signalled the end of New Romantic as a real force.
We kind of surfed in post New Romantic, if we're going to be Q magazine about it.
There were a lot of acts that I suppose tried to jump on the bandwagon of what they thought New Romantic was. And I mean, it was obviously a catastrophe with groups like Classics Nouveau was one I remember.
I didn't really mind Classics Nouveau. I think the punk in me felt vaguely antagonistic because I didn't like the fact that they were formed out of members of X-Ray Specs. It was such a great band. And then to see him going to do, you know, have a front man who's really, his only talent was his bald head, really. That struck me as being his big selling point, was the fact that he shaved his head. And I thought, well, most people could do that. It's not the way you look, it's not the way
that you smile. Whenever you talk about the 80s, that name always comes up, Flock of Seagulls. And I think it's quite funny. And it's just that hairdo, you know, it's that one sort of funny hairdo. If I had a photograph
of you. People kind of go, oh, yeah, it's just haircuts, man, you know, it's like kind of... Who are they kidding, man? Elvis was a haircut, you know. Lennon was a haircut.
Having seen many of his old crowd become successful, one-time Blitz cloakroom attendant George O'Dowd decided it was time to launch his own brilliant career.
I remember going to the job centre and saying I wanted to be a window dresser, or I wanted to be like a costume... You know, I wanted to work in a costume department in a theatre. They just looked at me like I was nuts. Yes, well, you know, we've got a job for you at Chingford's Fruit Packing Factory.
There was a shop in Carnaby Street that he used to work out of. And I remember going to that shop and it said, closed, gone to see a man from Virgin.
I needed to do something with my life because I realised that I couldn't just go around clubs forever, swanning around getting my photograph taken. My mum was like, I don't understand, why are people taking pictures of you? She didn't get it at all. So when I finally got the band together, I think they were really relieved because they could actually say, OK, this is what he does. Do you really want to hurt me?
To be a member of the Culture Club, you don't just have to know the music, but the style. The fans spend hours in front of the mirror emulating their hero, Boy George.
How long does it take you?
She does all the plaits herself.
Yeah, half an hour for the plaits.
Half an hour to do the plaits. What about the makeup?
Not very long, about 10 minutes.
I strongly believe that your fans are what you are. I mean, they make you what you are. You don't exist without them. I could waste a thousand
years. When I first started Culture Club, you know, people thought I looked outrageous. It was nothing. That was toned down to what I looked like before. I mean, it was totally toned down. I mean, I wouldn't have been able to kind of travel around the world with Culture Club with all those costumes. Marilyn's part of this kind of weird new romantic folklore, and people just really find him fascinating. Always want to know what he's doing, how he is, what colour lipstick he's wearing.
I remember I looked across the road once. He was at a bus stop and there was a queue of people and he was standing there in full drag, like just with a kind of skimpy dress on and shaving away at the bus stop.
Popular misconception is that I had a pop minute because of George. And that's so ridiculous, you know. People buy things because they like it. They don't buy it because they like something else.
Marilyn was beautiful looking, he had a great body. He had everything. Didn't have a good voice, but he had everything. And he could have really, you know, he could have done a lot more with his career had he not been so obnoxious to people. You know, because the minute he had a hit, he just turned into this, like, monster.
Inevitably, people link you with Boy George.
The reason why I was doing that was not because I was like a horrible, evil, bitchy queen, although that's how it came across. The reason I was doing it is because I was insecure and you know, I couldn't... I didn't believe that I was beautiful and fabulous and all the things people were saying to me at the time.
He's very intelligent, but there's a big difference between being intelligent and emotionally intelligent. Emotional intelligence is not something you get taught. You have to learn to be emotionally intelligent. And usually that comes via therapy, you know, or self-examination.
The Blitz closed in 1981, but the London scene entered a new phase with many of the original crowd setting out on their own.
Tony's walking up as he comes into the club and I'm standing there greeting. Pop stars in a very short period of time. So the club that I had was now frequented by pop stars.
By the time the scene moved into the Beatroot and we did Chart Number One video in the Beatroot, and it was, you know, the hottest club. I think that was our last hurrah, really, of Spandau being part of this movement.
So it went from being a Tuesday night out and then a Tuesday and a Thursday to being every night of the week. You could go to a club in London. Suddenly went
culture club, and you know, I think Wham were on their way through as a real commercialisation of this kind of music. We said goodbye to it. We went off to Nassau to make the True album. We couldn't remain a cult, we couldn't remain part of that and still do Top of the Pops.
Standing in the door of the Pink Flamingo, crying in the rain.
By 1982, Steve Strange and Rusty Egan were running the show at the Camden Palace, a mega club that regularly attracted over 1,000 of London's in crowd. In just 3 years, they'd emerged from small-time clubland to create a massive money-making enterprise.
How would you define the secret, then, of a successful nightclub like this?
You're looking at me. We have people like Sylvester Stallone, Grace Jones. We had all the top people that wanted to play there, like Frankie Goes to Hollywood, Eurythmics, Culture Club. I mean, it had all changed from the days of the Blitz, and it had all got very, very big and corporate.
Say hello, wave goodbye.
It was a kind of a big heroin explosion in London at that time, and it did afflate the club scene.
Everybody knows that I had a bad drug problem, but it's interesting because I went from being really, like, you know, kind of anti-drugs to being completely immersed in it.
The victims we know so well.
Somebody gave me this white powder. I've never ever tried drugs in my life before. And I thought, oh yeah, New Year's Eve fair, whatever.
But you're always there, like a ghost in my dream.
Lots of people that were around then did get involved seriously in heavy drugs, you know, and heavy sex. They're no longer with us now, or ended up in mental homes.
Have the strangest fight for you.
And I had 5-inch stilettos on. I was walked across the dance floor, got to the steps, and took one step, two steps, and I just went, everything went bang.
Like it's always been, and I
can hear my friend Robert, he was like, oh my God, looking at me, and I could hear it all going, what have you given him? You have it. And I went, heroin. I could hear it, and I went, heroin.
Myself, I had a heroin problem, which came later, but one thing that I never did was intravenously use heroin.
I do remember this girl, Mitsu, who's a very pretty, sort of Asian girl, beautiful, and she actually died of a drug overdose in Warren Street.
Wishing there was some kind of heaven.
Well, I had to go home to my mother's, and for about a week, my skin was like translucent white. You could see the green veins in my skin. You know, I looked like death, like I died. And I couldn't get out of bed for 5 days. 5 days.
It wasn't just a little disco, it was a complete life kind of environment that we lived in. I mean, it was like that 24 hours a day. It wasn't just one night a week getting dressed up and going to a nightclub.
I don't think people really realised, you know, how dangerous it all was, you know. I mean, there was that element, but that crept in much, much more towards the end of it. You know, that was the kind of end of it, really, that sort of, when it tore it all apart.
The scene that exploded around acid house and then again in the 90s was you could trace back to the Beetroot and the Blitz and one or two other clubs in London around that time.
It introduced one-off nightclubs, warehouse parties. It introduced the DJ, you know, the Rusty Egans, as the centre of attention. It introduced nightclubs where they tell you you can't come in unless you look right. None of that had existed before.
Before that, I mean, it was even very effeminate for a man to wear deodorant, let alone full face and makeup.
Men have, like, bathroom cabinets full of products now. You know, when I was a kid, it was like soap on a rope and Brute.
There was this colourful bang which revitalised pop culture and fashion and I think had a lot to do with revitalising London as a swinging city.
They helped make London saleable in the way that it is to the world now, a hotbed of creativity, hotbed of design.
That had time to dress up. It had time to be preposterous before it was scrutinised and splashed across everything and before it went mainstream. You know, that just wouldn't happen anymore.
I think people think they should fit in as opposed to stand out. It's when you go out in the street and everyone sort of looks the same. And they're all wearing uniforms almost.
I mean, I don't know what would inspire me if I was 14 now, you know. I don't know what I would look to, you know, Westlife.
Come and go. Love it will be the colors of light, man.